Hello and welcome to Let's Read the Books of Enderal. I'm Amethyst Lunatari. Today I'll be reading The Butcher of Ark, Volume 10, The Fall, which I found right here in Fortress Rockwatch. It's actually in the torture chamber. Chapter 10, The Fall. For several heartbeats I saw nothing. Then my view cleared, and I felt the fire fill my veins. With one eye I saw reality, how I sat on the edge of the bed, the blood-stained dagger still stuck in the body of my victim, which was weakly twitching in the throes of death. That vision was blurred and limited, equal to that of a man peeking through a keyhole into another room. What I witnessed with the other eye was clearer. His thoughts, his memories. I saw a corridor which was covered with red carpets. It was the corridor I had just walked through to get to Matumiel's room. From his room I heard sobs. I took a step toward the door and heard a voice from nowhere. It was hard, cold, and without love. "You are useless." I sensed that it belonged to Matumiel's father, who had died a short while ago. I went along. The sobs grew louder and mingled with screams. A jolt went through the spectral version of myself, and I was thrown into another memory before I could make it to the door to the bedroom. I saw him, 17 winters old, sitting at a large table laid out with all sorts of dishes. His head was lowered. On the other end of the table sat his father, whose face seemed familiar to me. A woman was sitting by his side, her eyes staring dreamily and impassively into the void, as if her mind was somewhere else. "This world is no place for weaklings. Why don't you understand?"
"I do, father."
Matumiel's voice was monotonous.
"Apparently you don't, or you would not behave like a damn fishwife."
The image turned black, and I was back in the hallway. The cries multiplied, echoing around me from different angles. I took a step toward the bedroom. One more. And another one. Then a new memory. This time I saw Matumiel standing by a door, with his back turned to it. He appeared to be listening. A man and a woman were shouting at each other in the adjacent room, the man furious and the woman pleading. I recognized the male voice as belonging to Matumiel's father. Again and again the dull sound of impact could be heard. I did not need to witness the scene in order to understand what was happening, and neither did Matumiel. His face was contorted in a grimace of disgust and anger. He despised him for what he did to his mother. He despised him for his deeds. I was back in the corridor, having arrived at the door to Matumiel's room. The fire burned greedily and glaringly in me, but the intoxication it sent through my veins felt wrong. I was supposed to feel triumphant, but instead I felt guilty, empty. "No," I whispered.
"He had killed. He had allowed the demons to enter him, and this was going to be his rightful punishment."
The door in Matumiel's memory swung open, and I entered. The room was similarly wrecked as the version in which my actual self was sitting beside his dying body. But now the chaos seemed more recent. The scattered sheets and books and the overturned table, the silent witnesses of an outburst of fury. Anger. Or despair? Matumiel was crouching on his bed, beardless and clean, completely unlike the man in whose throat I had just driven a dagger. Tears dried on his cheeks, tears that, I knew, his father had despised him for, calling him a girl. Now his eyes were dry and reddened, and they stared into nothingness like his mother's had in the dining room. He was broken. Why am I seeing this? I understood nothing of what was happening around me. What I was supposed to see were his sins, the moments in which he had allowed the demons to enter, the moments he had been weak and had chosen sin and greed instead of fortitude and virtue, the moments that had made him the monster that he was. Determined, I walked toward him. Lightning struck with a crash, illuminating the image. Then it returned to normal, and nothing had changed. Almost nothing. I was still in Matumio's room and in his head, but neither had the shelves been knocked over, nor was he crouching on the bed. In his stead, a book lay opened on the sheets. I leaned forward to read it. The ink on the first page was still fresh. 15th day of the Kraken, 8098, after Starfall. Father says there is no place in the world for weaklings, but he is wrong. It took me a long time to realize this, but I feel the truth in my words as I write them down. At first I hated him for his bad deeds, his shady dealings, his trips to the Undercity, the things he did to Mother that, without any doubt, contributed to her death. Why he has only ever injured me verbally instead of beating me is beyond me. Maybe because I am, after all, his son? I don't know. What he is unable to understand, though, is this simple truth. He is the true weakling. Despite wealth, status, and the honor of his path, he is little more than a desperate child inside, trying to use his power in order to gain acceptance and esteem. How easy it is to fall for this kind of pattern when we are not aware of it. I am ashamed at the thought of the things I've done. Little things they were, my mind tries to justify, but only now I realize how close I was to succumb to the very same cycle of violence and self-loathing as my father. Why did I beat up the noble boy? Back then, I said to myself, because he had treated me disrespectfully. Today I know that I only wanted to prove to my father that I'm actually a strong man, and I'm certain that if I had not realized it, one thing would have led to another, and harmless bullying would have resulted in much worse behavior. I would quickly have become exactly what I feared. My mind is made up. I will change. And once I am the upright person I am striving to be, my father will realize the perfidy of his deeds. I have it in me, and he has it as well. I believe it from the bottom of my heart. Stunned, I stared at the open diary in front of me. He wanted to change. Was it really possible? Were his intentions so noble? But how? I wondered. He was obsessed. And once the demons had lived inside a human for too long, there was no turning back. A luring uneasiness rose inside of me, and with horror I realized its familiarity. It was the feeling of being misguided which had made me leave Fogville, betray my path, and join the Black Libra. And now it was back again. I heard a heavy thud behind me, like a body falling to the ground. It was Matumio Daljul. An older man who I identified as a servant of the house was standing in the doorway. Matumio had fallen to the ground and buried his face in his hands. The fire raged wildly inside of me, but its intoxicating effect felt out of place, like an intruder. "We came too late," I heard the servant say. He looked to the ground as if to avoid the gaze of his master, although Matumio did not raise his head. "I am sorry." When he received no response, the old man turned around and left. A jolt shot through my body. The fire had fed. It had seen the sins. Matumio Daljul was dying. The spectral world around me began to fade, slowly but gradually, like the ink on a letter left in the rain. Irritated, I looked from the diary on the bed to the memory of the man whom I had judged, the man who had murdered 3 innocent people, the man who had given in to sin. He had despised his father's actions. He wanted to change himself and his father. Yet he had become a murderer. Why? What was the message delivered by the servant? A weak light started to glow inside of me, a shimmer of understanding. Who knows how things would have turned out if I had simply closed my eyes in the last moment I had been in Matumio's memory. But I watched. With a torturous slowness, my eyes wandered from the clean marble floor to the shelves filled with ancient knowledge, and stopped above the opulent door frame which I had crossed to enter the room. A round shield in a golden frame was attached to the wall, painted with a crest. It depicted a bear. My memories of the moments after I woke up are as pale and blurry as those of my escape from Fogville. I clearly remember, however, that I got up from the bed with slow, calm movements, which an outside observer might have misunderstood as a sign of serenity, or, in light of the act I had just committed, as a sign of cold-bloodedness. Matumiel Daljul was dead. I did not have to cast a look at him to know it. My heart pounded wildly in my chest, exhilarated by the nectar of his sins. Yet I felt cold. I do not recall my escape from the building anymore. When I approached the city gate, I could still smell the smoke of the fire I had set. The gate was closed, but there was light in the guardhouse. I had no idea how to explain to the guards why I wanted to leave the city at such a late hour, but I did not have to. In case of necessity, if it were the only way to gain distance, I would simply reduce the gate and every guard to ash. Again, I felt the old paralyzing fear in my stomach, only this time there was no escaping it. I had been following a lie from beginning to end. There were no demons taking possession of people. There were no sins, no corruption. There were only cause and effect. I myself had sealed young Daljul's fate by killing his father. He wanted to change. My eyes were burning, my limbs were hurting, my thoughts were not in harmony with the fire anymore. It sensed the dissonance and punished me for it.
"Go back," I heard its voice speaking to me from the blaze. "Go back and do what you are meant to do."
I ignored it. My fist was firmly clenched around my dagger while I walked toward the gatehouse. I saw the silhouette of a man flicker. The small building was separated from outsiders by bars. I swallowed, prepared myself for speaking, and halted. I knew the face that looked at me through the window, and I knew the smile luring on the lips. The man leaned back in the chair, legs crossed and arms behind his head.
"Where are you bound?" Kalian asked.
He spoke like a man who had run into a good friend after a long night in the taverns. I did not need the fire to realize what was going on inside my mentor's head. He can feel it. I remained silent, unable to respond. The situation reminded me of my old self, secluded, with a heavy tongue and no life experience. Kalian decided to remain silent as well, so we were left only observing one another for a while. His body seemed to cast no shadow despite the bright candlelight in front of him, but maybe it was only a figment of my imagination. Finally, he broke the silence. "I will not stop you, but they will come to get you." I said nothing. "We have all been where you are now." I was filled with a dull rage.
"Have you?"
"Yes, my friend." He let his gaze wander, as in many of our conversations before. "We have." "It is our fault, Kalian. It is not the fault of demons or sins. It is only our fault." A word formed on my tongue. First, there was a tickle, then there was a clear shape, and before I knew, I had spoken it. "It is a cycle." Kalian smiled like a master smiles at his student when he came to an understandable but naive conclusion. Then he shook his head. "I will not stop you," he repeated. "One day you will make a decision, and I hope it will be the right one." My hands were shaking, and my fear was overwhelming. I felt tears prick behind my eyes. It was all in vain. I had believed to be special, to make the world better with my deeds, to find my destiny. But I had not found anything. I had joined a group of lunatics who made themselves judge over life and death with wild magic and unholy rituals.
"Open the gate."
My voice was merely a whisper. Kalian nodded with a pinch of regret. He had expected my answer. 3 draws of breath later, the machinery started to move, and the gate rattled upward. I looked through it without looking at Kalian again. "No one leaves the Black Libra," I heard his voice behind me. It was neither angry nor malicious, only sad. "No one." I disappeared into the dark of night. My hand hurts. I sense that they are coming closer. I want to end it myself. I would like to claim that my reasons are admirable, or at least sympathetic in a way, like guilt or a sense of honor, but that would be a lie. Pure fear is driving me, fear of what the Black Libra does to traitors. The place where I started writing this transcript will be the place where I leave this world. Was it fate that my life was going to end here? The fact that I am hiding in an old abandoned trading post in the middle of a forest makes this conclusion likely. I was not aware of the irony of my fate before I woke up between these two cold stone walls yesterday morning. I had wandered all night, and I remember the strange figure walking 30 arms' lengths in front of me at all times. I had followed. Shortly before I had found the clearing, she turned toward me a last time and smiled at me. The adornment in her hair had sounded like wind chimes from Kilay. Then she had disappeared, like she had never been there in the first place. I wish I had more meaningful words to end this transcript, but I don't. As I have mentioned before, it is meant to be an account, nothing more. An account of what made Jael Tannerson, the Nameless One, the Butcher of Ark. I am so tired that my eyes are filled with tears, and my hands are shaking in anticipation of what I am about to do. Several dozen people died by my blade, yet I am too cowardly when it comes to taking my own life. I have a final plea to you. My story will not only be twisted by heralds and the Order, but also by the Black Libra. It was born in the shadows, and there it will remain. Nowhere will you find traces of its deeds, and with artfulness and treachery, it will cover the traces I am leaving behind. Besides simple explanations, I was straying from my path. I was a monster. There will be other assertions which will satisfy scholars and philosophers. Do not listen to them. They are nothing but lies. Epilogue. Letter of the Chronicler. Dear Terras, I had to chuckle upon reading your latest letter. No, the Black Libra does not exist. And yes, I do consider your research on its machinations a waste of time. Why, you ask me? It is very simple. Jael Tannerson was stark raving mad up to the last sensible corner of his brain. He suffered from horrid delusions, and nearly everything you have read in the previous pages is nonsense. Now, I am well aware that this claim fits the book's closing statement only too well, but allow me to shed light on the life and deeds of the Butcher of Ark, on what truly happened, and you will see how what I say is infinitely more sensible than Tannerson's metaphysical ramblings on demons, the Black Libra, and the fire. Jael Tannerson was born to a common carpenter and his companion in the year 8056 after Starfall in a small village called Northwind. Therefore, his true age at the beginning of the chronicle was 32 instead of 28. This also increases the age at which he was abandoned from 2 to 4. Being of frail stature and small body size, his age seems to have simply been underestimated. His natural father went by the name of Samael Chipblade, and was an utterly violent and mentally challenged man. Both of these streaks, it pains me to say, have to be attributed to his deeply rooted religiosity. Obsessively punctual, he visited the local temple several times per day to pray, never missed even a single mass or sermon, and was able to recite all of the path's 101 verses in their full length. Nothing was more important to him than to abide by the path and to love our Lord Malphus, and these were his exact expectations of his fellow villagers, too. Which, as you might be able to guess, led to him living a very isolated life. Though he usually followed the priest's sermons, he often thought their contents too shallow and Northwind's handling of pathlessness too lenient. When he did not pray, he worked, denying himself desires such as lovemaking, alcohol, and even music. And so the village was surprised when rumors that Samael would become a father began to circulate. Though he denied it, everyone knew who the mother was, a young wandering whore often seen at his house in the past weeks. The public knowledge of the pregnancy put Samael in a difficult situation, abandoning a pregnant woman and thus committing murder on babe and woman both was a grave sin, even if the woman concerned was of low status or a whore. But more importantly, it did not in the least fit his self-perception. So he picked the only option available to him. He married the woman, not older than 20 winters at the time, and 5 months later the young Jael was born. As one might imagine, he was not born under a lucky star. though Samael had always been inclined toward aggressive and quick-tempered behavior, according to the priest I interrogated, this aggression only increased with parenthood. The fear and horror recognizable in Chipblade's young companion had been almost palpable during the three-day mass, he confessed. So things took their course, and, as if he had not already done so, Samael increasingly sealed himself and his family off from the outside world. But now you will have guessed what had happened, dear Taras, so we will keep things short. Samael Chipblade abused both his companion and his young son. What began with scolding looks and curses slowly turned to regular beatings with a birch. This he, of course, merely did to protect his loved ones, as he confessed to the priest once. Both his companion and his boy were befallen by demons, horrible demons whose only purpose was to drive them from the right path, to taint them. One cannot purge them forever, he had said to the priest, his voice shaking, because they always return, no matter what you do, no matter how devoted the prayers or how chaste one's thoughts. They always return. Why the priest didn't intervene? He did not fully suspect how bad things truly were. Corporal punishment for children and women is not unheard of, especially not among the rural populace, and the truth only dawned on him when, one morning, he watched a young woman go to the village's well. A gust of wind freed her from her veil and revealed an abundance of cuts, bumps, and broken bones. Do you remember the butcher's crow-like nose? It is a remnant of such an exorcism. There is little more to say of this sad period of his life except for its tragic end. In an act of despair, Jael's mother took her own life, but only after she had crushed her husband's skull with a heavy hammer. The starving boy was found 5 days later in his parents' bedchamber, the empty eyes focused on the bloody shrine of Malphus. To this day, I do not know whether he had been present during the horrible deed, or whether he had entered the room when both parents were already dead. He did not cry, spoke no word, and his eyes were nothing like those of a four-year-old anymore. When I asked why the boy had not been given to a family from the village, the priest confessed with lowered eyes that no one was willing to take him in. A child had already seen murder and violence at such a young age would undoubtedly bring misfortune on those near it, people said. And besides, times were hard and wheat scarce. In the end, Jael was wrapped in a woolen blanket, and the priest traveled with him to the fog road and deposited him before a shrine, in the hopes that someone would take pity on the young boy. You already know of Gilman, the tanner who would later raise him. He shared neither Samael Chipblade's religious fervor nor his brutality, but, as you certainly concluded from the butcher's writings, he provided in everything for the boy except an environment in which his scarred soul could heal. As he turned 11 winters old, he began an apprenticeship with the local priest and came to oversee the Temple of Fogville 5 years later. The villagers saw him as a silent, dutiful man with a constantly uneasy expression, and it did indeed take 3 days before his disappearance following the Star Summer Night's feast was noted. In the third chapter of his account, Jael finally tells us of the events that transpired at the Red Ox, a small tavern not far from Ark, where an essentially harmless act of revenge escalated into his first killing. In incredible detail, he recounts the inebriating feelings which took hold of him during the murder. Then, turning his attention to his first encounter with Killian, who accompanied him as a mentor and friend during the following moons and winters. Here, however, fact and fiction, truth and fantasy, begin to mix for the first time. The innkeeper of the Red Ox might still remember a sad-looking, thin man being humiliated, who then, together with the two riders, had disappeared early in the following morning. A man such as Killian, however, had never been seen at the tavern. Now, while this inconsistency might be attributed to the countless faces the innkeeper must have encountered since, the fact that both giants, Narratil and Jura Dalkarrik, who are indeed quite nasty fellows, have been seen in Ark a few days later, both in perfect health, makes opposition pointless. No, you have not misread, Taras. Both men, who, according to the butcher, died a bloody death that night, are in fact well and alive, and I have actually spoken to them during my inquiries. I don't know what truly happened at the Red Ox, but I strongly suspect that on that evening, Jael's inner need to take revenge for his humiliation caused his insanity to take root for the first time. He felt weak, and the violence he was subjected to subconsciously reminded him of the situation his father used to put him in. But at the same time, he was obviously lacking the power to do something against this, and at this point his imagination gained the upper hand, and he conjured up a variant of the events which was simply never true. He subsequently fled into the forest. Now, you may say that my claim that the murders were a mere product of his imagination is nothing more than conjecture, but let me first continue with my account and explain my underlying thesis later. About 6 moons before the murders, with a proven connection to Jael Tannerson began, he claims to have arrived in Ark. He posits to have found refuge in a tavern together with his mentor and his companions, only to wipe out a sort of child's brothel in the Undercity the following day, together with this Kalian. Again, the innkeeper of the Dancing Nomad recognized Jael on a drawing, but was unable to remember a person fitting the description of Kalian. Even the brothel I mentioned has never existed in the form described, as my contacts in the Undercity have assured me. But is secrecy and covertness not the entire point of such an institution? You might ask me now. Yes, Der Turas, it is. But such an establishment could only exist under the protection of a large organization such as the Relata, and under these circumstances you can be assured that the destruction of such a, it pains me to say, profitable source of income would not have been tolerated by the Relata. No, both of us know what that organization is capable of and what they do to those acting against their authority. What actually happened was that more and more homeless and sick people were found murdered in the Undercity's alleys, all of them barely recognizable from myriads of stabbing wounds, Tannerson's thumbprint. The first instance of both Jael's narrative and the truth aligning occurred 3 months later and coincides with the passing of the so-called trial. Back then, the first corpses had been discovered, and here we begin to speak of the Butcher of Ark due to the brutality of the victims' deaths. The following year, during which Jael wreaked havoc in Ark, managing to escape first the guard and later the Holy Order itself, due to his perfidious intelligence, a total of 24 murders were committed where the Butcher's involvement is beyond doubt, and another 12 where it cannot be ruled out. A second person was never involved, and not all of his victims had been guilty of crimes. You probably ask yourself the same question as in the beginning of this letter. Why the deviations? Why invent a mysterious secret society with the aim to keep evil in check? Why the talk of a nectar of sin enabling the murderer to enter the memories of his victims to be rewarded with sexual ecstasy? I, for my part, have found a solution to this riddle, and it rests on my conviction that very few of the world's murderers and criminals view themselves as evil, instead believing to do the right thing. We are so good at creating models of thought that help us in reconciling our deeds with our self-perception. This was no different with Jael Tannerson, and the essence of what caused him to commit his crimes is firmly rooted in his childhood. You can surely imagine that his childhood had profound effects on Jael Tannerson. I am certain that, on a subconscious level, Jael knew what his father did unto him, and that he hated him with a passion. You also know that children cannot yet distinguish between themselves and their environment, especially in early years. I suspect this was the case with Jael, too. The more he hated his father, the more he hated himself, blamed himself for the pain endured by his mother and him. His father had said it, hadn't he? I only want to protect you. It's the demons. Always the demons. You always allow them back into your hearts. Again and again the boy failed in this. Again and again. And again he and his mother had to pay dearly for it. How he wished for peace, his father's love, for harmony. But he would never receive it, for when the demons possessed his mother one last time, they robbed him of the only two people he had ever known. Unable to even try to process his experiences, the horrible images, the raw hate, the guilt, and a biting accusation, A deeply rooted realization were confined in a mental casket that his child's mind buried deep in his subconsciousness, so that it would feel nothing but a diffuse, omnipresent fear that kept him from ever experiencing something like true happiness. Until the day of his trauma, when he was confronted with his repressed memories for the first time by seeing his own corpse. I am sure that finding his own rotting corpse represented the part of him which had been repressed and locked away, slumbering all these years. Now, however, its burdening presence had grown too strong to ignore any longer. He would die if he did not learn to understand, calm or heal it, and so he fled over heels from his life, his only compass being an impalpable feeling which would lead to his death, much like the flame is to the moth. It punished him with an insufferable fear when he acted against it, and it rewarded him with maniacal ecstasy when he did something right. Without that feeling, he would never have left his village, never begun to kill for his imaginary construct of the Black Libra. Indeed, without it, he would never have become the Butcher of Ark, instead ending his peaceful, if a bit sad, existence as a priest of Fogville. He dubbed this feeling fire. I call it searching for forgiveness. With every decision, with every murder, every step he took, he wanted only one thing, to triumph where he had failed before, to finally achieve the peace he had always hoped for. He wanted to cleanse the world of the demons that had caused so much suffering for his family. His father had, after all, only wanted to protect his family from them. Can you follow? The demons, the fire, the Black Libra, it was all nothing more than his subconscious desire for absolution. Absolution for a crime he never committed. The demons Jael saw in his victims were nothing more than projections of the guilt he felt for the deaths of his parents, and by murdering, he tried to atone for it. Maybe my thesis seems absurd to you at first glance, but think of all the parallels between Jael's account and his past. The most obvious would likely be his choice of words, sinner, demon, and soul cleanser. Humanity is weak and rotten, but there was a hidden order protecting it from its downfall. What could this be if not a reconstruction of his familial background? It continues with the imaginary person of Killian. Is he not an idealized incarnation of what Jael would have wanted to be? Strong, lawless, full of desire to live, and absolutely devoted to the Black Libra, without the doubts Jael had until the end, and that would ultimately be the cause of the final parallel to his childhood, his failure. Though dozens had to give their life because of Tennyson's mad quest for forgiveness, it ended with the same cognition as for the small boy in the past. But no matter the self-sacrifice, in the end he had been too weak. His will, his scrupulousness, his belief in the righteousness of his cause, it was to no avail. He had failed, and left this world as a broken man. You see, dear Therese, the parallels are too obvious to be merely accidental. I have been unable to decipher merely two symbols in this story, the veiled woman appearing in his vision and the admission ritual. I do have my theories, but they are vague still. You can calmly lean backwards, however. The day a wild mage enters your room to kill you and then digest your sins, I am sure there are countless, will not arrive. The Black Libra does not exist, and neither does the fire or Killian. To me, the story of the Butcher of Ark is primarily the sad testimony of a man who took countless innocent lives on his quest for forgiveness. Who, in the end, is to blame? He? His father? And if you choose the latter, how can you know whether Samael Chipblade, with his sick religiosity and his purges, too, had been merely trying to heal a scar on his soul, a scar he also had no fault in creating? Here, Jael Tennyson was right. It is an eternal chain of cause and effect, a cycle. And nowhere in it will you find someone to blame. Carolil Dalgamar, Arcanist of the Third Sigil and Chronicler of the Holy Order. Thank you for listening to Let's Read the Books of Enderal, The Butcher of Ark, Volume 10, The Fall.